It's Friday night. The unfettered city resounds with hedonistic glee. John feels a cold cast of self-pity envelop him. No family. A linkless node, no spouse or sibling, no children, John wanders alone into an ice cream parlor, nibbling the edges of a sugar cone by turns a pair of high school lovers stand giggling. John, uncharmed, discovers his favorite flavors, pumpkin pie and bubble gum, decides to buy a double scoop, sits down. But whether his eyes fall on a knot of three schoolgirls, a clamorous family, or munching cheerfully together, a hippie and a Castro clone, it hurts that only he's alone. He thinks back to his days at college, to Phil, to Berkeley friends, to nights when the pursuit of grades and knowledge foundered in beery jokes and fights. Eheu Fugakis, Silicon Valley, lures to ambition's ulcer alley young graduates with siren screams of power and wealth beyond their dreams, ejects the lax and drives the driven, burning their candles at both ends. Thus, files take precedence over friends. Labor is lauded, leisure riven. John kneels bareheaded and unshod before the chip, a jealous god, as did Phil too, until his recent flight from the rich realms of defense, with what John holds to be indecent precipitation and bad sense. John, still engaged in such endeavors, feels Phil's new zest for piecework severs a thread of mutual interest. He almost fears to call him lest political debate should color a friendship based on easy cheer, light camaraderie, dark beer, and double dating. Life's grown duller since when, time. They used to share the aegis of the Golden Bear. He phones Phil, the first time in ages, but there's no answer. Friday night. He idly thumbs the scribbled pages of his address book. Well, he might phone Janet Hayakawa. Many seasons have sunk since there was any hazard a meeting could adduce their former love. A standing truce shelters their friendship from all passion. They'd felt their union would constrict their separate lives. An interdict agreed by both, after a fashion, they went about their singular ways. Slaves to the chip or artist's days. She is a sculptor. Stress and pleasure for her thus perfectly combined, the boundaries of toil and leisure by definition ill-defined, her work time doubles as her playtime. But hand and eye deployed in daytime yield when night comes to ear and hand. She is the drummer in a band well known and feared throughout the city. The striking sounds of liquid sheep rouse distant suburbs from their sleep. Unlinked alike to tune or ditty, their music is a throttled yelp, Morse crossed with a pig's squeal for help. John stands beside his phone, recalling Janet's warm beauty, smiling calm, her dark eyes, high-boned features, falling black ponytail, her vagrant charm. He thinks, I guess I'll be the wiser for talking to a sound advisor. He dials. To his peeved surprise, an answering machine replies, requests his message, name, and number.
Wait for the beep.
John says, it's me, John, 243-4963. No message. Rather than encumber the brusque machine with his heart's woes, he wraps himself in pensive prose. He hears the phone ring.
Hello, John. Are you okay? What's going on? I just got back. I thought I'd phone you, although it's late. You sounded bad on the machine, more tired and sad than in the whole time that I've known you.
It's nothing.
Tell you what, let's meet for lunch tomorrow, 16th Street.
John thinks, it's not that I'm fastidious. I wish they'd turn that music down. It's gross. Oh, that calendar is hideous. He stares at the distasteful clown. I've waited half an hour, blaster.
Her hands encased in clay and plaster. Janet arrives at 12 to 2. So sorry, John. I had to do this torso. Yes, I tried to hurry. Oh, I'm glad you've got yourself a beer. What's that? Tsing Tao. Don't look severe. I didn't mean for you to worry. You've ordered. No? Oh, this place is fun. Oh, what do you have? Oh, it's family run.
The food arrives as soon as ordered. Impressed and ravenous, John relents. His chopsticks fasten on beef bordered with broccoli. Enticing scents swim over the noise, the greasy table. Two bottles each of beer enable small talk and large in cyclic waves to wash their shores. And John behaves at last less stiffly, if not sadly. How are the cats?
Just fine.
And you?
Great.
And the sculpture?
Yes, that too.
Your singing group?
Oh, not too badly. But I came here to hear your song. Now sing.
Jan, I don't know what's wrong. I'm young, employed, healthy, ambitious, sound, solvent, self-made, self-possessed. But all my symptoms are pernicious. The Dow Jones of my heart's depressed. The sunflower of my youth is wilting. The tower of my dreams is tilting. The zoom lens of my zest is blurred. Oh, the drama of my life's absurd. What is the root of my neurosis? I jog, eat brewer's yeast each day, and yet I feel life slip away. I wait your sapient diagnosis. I die, I faint, I fail, I sing.
You need a lover, John, I think. We need, first off, says Janet dryly, a venue to begin from.
What?
Your office, John, she ventures slyly. Any nice women?
Not too hot.
Any nice guys?
Oh, come on, Janet. I just don't go for that, so can it?
I've got it, John. The perfect answer. Oh, I should have thought of it. My friend, your sufferings are at an end.
That sounds as terminal as cancer. Let's hear it. With a tame surmise, he listens.
Jan says, advertise.
What? Advertise? You must be joking.
I'm serious.
Jan, you're nuts.
I'm not.
You know, Jan, you've had such a soaking in Tsingtao, you don't know what's what. Me advertise? You must be kidding.
Kiddo, I'm not. Just do my bidding. Take out an ad right now, today. Young, handsome, yuppie seeks.
No way!
The family at the next table are listening in with interest. But John, at least when you feel able, why don't you put it to the test?
But it's so desperate, so demeaning.
Johnny boy, your mind needs cleaning of the debris of prejudice.
Jan, what has that to do with this?
Its definition is, states Janet, judging a thing before it's tried.
But it's the same for suicide, says John, or blowing up the planet. Why should I try it first to see if it agrees or not with me?
John, things we would, when young, not think of, start to make sense when on the brink of 30-dom we pause to scan what salves and salads cannot ban. The earliest furrows on our faces, the loneliness within our souls, our febrile clawing for mean goals, our programmed cockfights and rat races, our dreary dignity, false pride, and hearts stored in formaldehyde. Time sidles by. On television, the soaps dissolve, the jingles change. Defeat, or pity, or derision constricts our hearts. Our looks grow strange, even to us. The grail, perfection, dims, and we come to view rejection as an endurable result of hope and trial. And exult when search or risk or effort chances to grant us someone who will do for love, and who may love us too. While those who wait as age advances, aloof from Ms. or Mr. Right, weep to themselves in the still night.
Young, handsome yuppie, 26, straight, forward, sociable but lonely, cannot believe that he's the only well-rounded and well-meaning square lusting for love. If you out there are friendly female under 30, impulsive, fit and fun, let's meet. Be rash. 220 Judah Street.
Dear Yuppie, I'm friendly, female, 27, well-rounded too, and somewhat square. I've not yet known romantic heaven, but harbor hopes of getting there. I'm fit, at least I'm not convulsive, and fun, I hope, though not impulsive. To match the handsomeness you flaunt, I do not mean this as a taunt, I find modesty disarming. I have heard several people say I am good-looking in my way. So if you'd like to meet Prince Charming, that shows discernment. If you flout my charms, you are a tasteless lout. With all good wishes, yours sincerely, Elizabeth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.